Yet now. Sit.
God bless you all today. God bless you all this morning. This morning we're here to praise and worship the Lord. We're going to hear from the Word of God today. But today is the day that we remember that Christ is alive, that Christ is risen from the dead. Because the Word of God tells us in the book of Matthew 28, verse 6, He is not here, for He is risen. As He said, come see the place where the Lord lay. And we know that place, that tomb in Jerusalem today, is an empty tomb. Because we know that the Lord Jesus Christ is alive today. He sits at the right hand of the Father, interceding for those whom He loves. And that's good news this morning, that we can put our hope and our trust in the Saviour of the world this morning. But let's bow our heads this morning, and let's ask God this morning to pour out the Spirit. Father, we come before You today, Lord. And we ask You for an outpouring of Your Spirit this morning, Lord God. That throughout the land this morning, my God, as people come into Your presence, O Lord, to praise and to worship Your name, O Lord, that we give thanks this morning for Your holy name, my God. We give thanks this morning for the cross of Christ. We give thanks that it was Your blood, my God, that cleanses this morning, my God. We thank You this morning, my God. That, Lord, without You, we can do nothing this morning, Lord. And we know that through the living and enduring Word of God, we can trust in Your Word, O Lord. That, Lord, Your Word will never fail us, my God. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Glorify Your name. Amen.
Glory, honor,
Sunday, and it's a day we will celebrate the risen Christ, but for me as a believer, And most Christians this morning, this is a day that we celebrate mostly every day of our lives as Christians, that Christ is alive. You know, many people will watch worldwide today, TV, media, Easter services, as a religious event. But this morning, I want to preach. Today, I want to preach what the Bible says. This day is about the day of the cross. This day is about the day of Christ being risen from the dead. But we have to understand and know what it cost, what the cross was about. What was this crucifixion about? And the word of God says in a very well-known passage of scripture that I've used many, many times in preaching the gospel in 1 Corinthians 1:18. It says, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those who are being saved, it's the power of God. And this morning, the message of the cross, about the crucifixion, it might seem foolish to you that a man called Jesus Christ over 2,000 years ago would go to the cross of Christ and die. But today, we must understand what the Word of God says, according to the Scriptures, that Christ died according to the Scriptures, that he was buried and he rose again. He was that Passover lamb. But today, the message is what makes you believe this? What makes me believe this? And what I want to bring the message about this morning is the Scriptures show and point to Christ. You know, I believe in this, this morning, the 66 books of the Bible. And the Bible is a collection of 66 books. It was written over 1600 years ago, across three continents, 40 writers, three languages, 39 books of the Old Testament, 27 of the New Testament. The 39 books of this Old Testament point to Jesus. They point to the Messiah. And the 27 of the New Testament books speaks of this Messiah. And this is why I can base my Christianity upon this morning, of true facts of what the Bible says, because we know that all Scripture is given by inspiration by God. It's useful for teaching, correction, rebuking, and training in righteousness. We know that the prophets of Scripture never came by the will of men. The holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. So we know that the Scriptures are written by God as men were carried along. And I want you to know that the Bible prophesies the Messiah would come through the Scriptures. He would come through the Scriptures. And I want to look up this morning, if you have a paper or a pen, write these down, so I'll take a note of them this morning. Because I won't have time to go through them, because I want to try to keep the message short. But I want to look to some biblical facts about the Messiah Jesus. And you know what? You know, if you look, I could go to every Old Testament book, and I could show you the point of the Christ, the Messiah. But I just want to look at a few facts that you know that was fulfilled. And many, many people say, oh, the New Testament contradict the Old, and the Old Testament contradict the New. But I can show you and prove you from the Scripture, they back each other up. In the book of Genesis 49, verse 10, it says the Messiah would come from the tribe of Judea, from one of the 12 tribes of Israel. And you read in the account of the genealogy in Matthew 1:1-16, it will give you that where Jesus came from, that line. Now that's an importance. We know that he had to come from the line of Judea, one of the 12 tribes of Israel. The Messiah would be the descendant of King David. And we can read that in Jeremiah 23:5 or Psalms 132:11. And we read that again in the genealogy in Matthew 1. That he would come from the line of King David. We know that many, many events it speaks about in the Word of God. You know that Jesus was born, and many people will miss this by this time because we'll just look to the resurrection. But Jesus would be born in a town called Bethlehem. And we can look at the book of Micah 2:5-2. It says the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. And we read that in Matthew 2:1. That the Messiah would be born of a virgin. Isaiah 7:14, and the Word of God says in the book of Matthew 1:23 that Mary was conceived by the Holy Spirit. So we know that he had to be immaculate, that he was born of a virgin. The Messiah would enter Jerusalem on a colt donkey. That was prophesied in the book of Zechariah 9 verse 9, and that came to pass in the book of Luke 19 verse 35. All these took events, 760 years, 740 years, 1505 years before Christ even came to this earth, before it even came. The Bible even speaks about many people. If you look at religious films this time of year, or if you look, you've heard about a man called Judas and how he betrayed Jesus. That was actually spoken 520 years before Christ. Then the book of Psalms 41 verse 9, that he'd be betrayed. But we know that in the book of Matthew 26, 21, that he was betrayed. The Messiah betrayed a 30 piece of silver. The book of Zechariah 11 verse 12. And that came to pass again in Matthew 26, 14, 578 years before Christ. That the Messiah be mocked. The Bible speaks about this in the book of Psalms 22, verse 7 to 8. And we know that in the book of Matthew 27 again, 39 down, it reads about the mocking that Jesus took. The Bible also says in Isaiah 53 that he would be despised and rejected by men. That was prophesied 740 years before Christ. And we know as we read this in the book of Luke again, 23:20, that he was despised and he was rejected. And in Isaiah 53 verse 5, it speaks that he'd be flogged, that he was wounded for our transgressions. And the word wounded means he'd be pierced. And this speaks about, again, in Matthew 27:26, about the crucifixion. And remember at this point in time, the Romans invented the crucifixion, and this was a prophecy 740 years before Christ was even crucified. Crucifixion wasn't even invented at this time, but it said that he would be wounded for our transgressions. And he was pierced. The Bible speaks about, again, in Matthew 22:14, it says that he would die a brutal death. The Bible says that he was marred beyond recognition. He had no resemblance of a human being. The beating and the mocking that Christ took. The Bible says that his back was torn open like a fowl on a field, like a plough field. That's how much the whipping and the lashing, the beating he took. And that was prophesied 520 years before Christ was even beaten and mocked. Again, in Isaiah 53:12, it speaks the Messiah would make an atonement for sin once and for all. You know that in the Old Testament speaks about an animal had to take place and die for a temporary covering for sin. But the Word of God says that Christ would come as that one's sacrifice. The Bible says in Hebrews 9:28, so Christ was offered once to bear the sins of men, so that who eagerly await for him will appear a second time apart from sin, but for salvation. Thanks be to God. That's good news this morning for those in Christ Jesus. And if you don't know Jesus Christ this morning, you can accept him as your personal Lord and Savior, and you can have your sin dealt with this morning. These are true biblical facts this morning that I'm sharing this morning to know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And these were Old Testament facts we can look at from the birth to his death, that we can take place, that we can put our trust and our salvation this morning, because salvation is a lifeline that God has thrown out to mankind. It means deliverance. If you was drowning out in the sea and someone threw a lifeline, that you'd hold on and you'd grab on, wouldn't you? And that's where it's a means of salvation. And the Word of God says that salvation, book of Acts 4:12, it says that salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven among men by which we must be saved, and that name is Jesus Christ. Today, for the believer, this might sound, he's just sharing the gospel, but this is a fact that the apostle Paul spoke of and encouraged the believers in Corinth to remain there in this fact. If you have Bibles this morning, I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1. And he says, moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which you stand, by which also you are saved if you hold fast the words that I preached to you, unless you believe in vain. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried and that he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas and by the 12. And after that he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, to whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep. Here we see the Apostle Paul this time now is encouraging the believers to believe these things. He said, moreover, brethren, so here we see the Apostle Paul speaking to believers. So he's encouraging the gospel which they have received. He's moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel. And there's something within this declare. It needs to make known, or to make known afresh. He's making it known afresh in this form. I'm making it known afresh to you this morning, for the believer, that we need to make it afresh this morning. The gospel is the most important thing of our lives. Because it's the gospel that saves you today. It's the gospel which we stand by. He goes on to say this gospel which I preach to you. This word preaching is that he proclaimed it. And he proclaimed it to the Corinthian church, but also he proclaims it to us in the way. I proclaim this message to you today, and which you received, this message that you received, is by which you must stand. This morning we must stand upon the word of God. We must stand, because the word of God says, heaven and earth will flee, but the word of God remains. And you know, you can base upon anything else in this life, and let me tell you, it will fail, it will fall. But today, if you base your life upon Jesus Christ, he will never let you down. He will never let you fall. Because the word of God is something that you can stand upon. The word of God is that which will remain forever. This is the message by which we stand. The message you received and you stand by, that you must take it to heart, by which you are saved, he says in verse 2. If you hold fast the word which I preach to you, unless you believe. And this is something that God really pressed as I began to look at this. And I suppose that the apostle was trying to show the people this time in Corinth. And there's something that we must take to heart. This is the message, but you're saved if you hold fast to it. This word, hold fast, if you look at it, it's a word that, like a grip that you wouldn't let go. That's what it means. It was a word that you wouldn't let go. So this morning, you don't let go of this gospel which you have received. So in a sense, it shows that something can take this gospel from you. The Bible speaks about in Galatians, if it's even given of the gospel, if it's even an angel appears, let the gospel, let him be accursed. But the gospel is the gospel of Jesus Christ, which we take our stand by. The gospel that our faith is, that we trust in this morning. And this is what we hold fast to. But this word hold fast is, don't let go of your belief. Don't let go this morning of this gospel which you stand by. Because let me tell you, it can be snatched away by the world, by its desires. The things of this world can come on you, the desires of the world, the desires of riches, the desires of this, the desires of that. I want this, I want that. But this morning, our faith and our trust and our hope is in Jesus Christ this morning. And we must hold fast to this. The reason why, he says, that if you hold fast, the word which I preach to you. So he's remembering the word that I preached to you must hold fast to this morning. If you believe and you've received and you're walking in faith, hold on to it. But this morning, if you've let go of this word and the message which we've received, the message you've believed in this morning, if you've let go of it this morning, the word of God says you've believed in vain. You believed in vain. So what does that mean? That means all that you believed before was meaningless. You know, you could say that I've said a sinner's prayer 20 years ago, 30 years ago, accepted the Lord my life then. But let me tell you, friend, if you're not walking in the ways of God and you just go by that sinner's prayer, you believed in vain. If you think that I'll believe in my own way, but let me tell you, the word of God says that there's a way that seems right to man, but in the end it leads to death. We can't believe in the Scriptures our own way. We have to take the word, what the word of God has telling us. By which we are saved, if you hold fast, I preach to you, unless you believed in vain. Because there is a way that seems right to man. But Jesus said in the word of God, in John 14:6, he says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. He says, and no one can come to the Father but by me. See, friend, there's no other way. There is no other way. See, people of the world today, as I said, it's a religious day for some people, will say, I'm a Christian. They may once confess Christ. Or you might take the name of a Christian, whatever religion you are, whatever religious sect or religious system you're from. But the point is that Jesus Christ came to this earth over 2,000 years and died, was that you would repent from your sins and you'd receive forgiveness of what Jesus did upon the cross for you. That's why you must repent this morning and turn from your sins. Because Jesus Christ is your only hope. Your religion, friend. Many people in the world today will have a religion they will hold on to because maybe their parents or their grandparents or their great-grandparents or what you've been fetched from. Let me tell you, religion don't save you. Religion don't hold you. Religion is man's attempt to reach God. But let me tell you, God came down and reached you upon a cross over 2,000 years ago. The Word of God says that God demonstrated his own love towards us, that while we're still sinners, that Christ died for us. The book of Romans 5:8 shows us that God demonstrated his own love towards us, that all we're sinners, that Christ died. But the Word of God says in verse 8 that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and verse 4, that he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures. That's why I can base my Christianity, my life with God upon it, because Christ died according to for my sins, according to the Scriptures, because sin separates mankind from God. Because God is a holy God, and God will not, God has to deal with sin because he's a holy God. He can't turn a blind eye to it, he can't wink at it, he has to deal with it. And there's a penalty for sin. Because the Word of God says the wages of sin is death. And probably most people believe it was borrowed too, because we know he wasn't going to remain there very long. But the Word of God says that 3 days later, that he rose from the dead. And that's why the message of the cross is powerful. That's why the Lamb of God, come and take away the sin of the world, because Jesus is alive, he is not dead, he is risen, he sits at the right hand of the Father, interceding for you this morning, for those who he loves this morning. And for you who don't know Jesus Christ, he loves you this morning too. He loves you with everlasting love, that he gave his life that you may have everlasting life. That you don't have to pay for your penalty for sin and go to the place called hell, but he loves you this morning. And for those who are in Christ, the Word of God says that who the Son sets free is free indeed this morning. He set you free from the power of sin and death. Because death has lost its sin. Thank God he is the Lamb of God. But this morning you have to put your trust in him. You need to trust in Jesus today. You have to put your faith and your hope and the trust in what Jesus did upon the cross. And the burial and the resurrection of the Lord. Jesus said in his word, I am the resurrection of the life. He said, if you believe in me, well, even though he died, he will live. So this morning, there's hope for those that went on before us this morning, that Jesus is alive this morning. He's the first fruit of the resurrection this morning. And this morning, we have to put our faith and our trust in him this morning. To believe this today, we must do with the Word of God says. In the book of Romans 10:9, it says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised you from the dead, you will be saved. Salvation this morning can come to your house this morning. Salvation can come to you in your living room this morning. Salvation can come to you in your car this morning. Salvation can come to you wherever you are this morning. If you're backslidden, you're not right standing with Jesus Christ this morning. This day is not a religious day, friend. This day is the day that Jesus Christ is alive, that you rise from the dead, and you can put your faith and your hope and trust in him this morning. But today you must trust him. Today you must put your faith in him today. Because he is alive. Because the Word of God says, and he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures. A fact that we know that he did. There's a tomb in Jerusalem, you can go to there this morning, and it's empty. There's no skeleton there. But there's many, many religions. You can go to tombs, you can go to graves throughout the land, throughout the world, and you'll find there's tombs, and there's, you know, you'll see skeletons there, you'll see someone's been there. Friend, they can't save you. But there's one man who can. And his name is Jesus.
Amen.
He's a life friend. He's alive forevermore. And he sits at the right hand of the Father interceding for those he loves. And he loves you today with this everlasting love. Today, put your hope. Put your trust in Jesus today. Because he is risen. He is alive. And alive forevermore. God bless you all today. Amen. Let's bow our heads and pray this morning. And this morning, as we bow our heads and pray this morning, you ask the Lord this morning. Maybe you're not in a place where you should be. Maybe you want to draw close to the Lord, closer relationship with Jesus. Today, you can put your hope and your trust in him. Today, if you're backslidden in your heart this morning, he is one prayer away. Put your life right for the Lord this morning. Father, we come before you this morning. And we ask in that name that's above all names, Lord. Those who put their faith and their trust in you this morning would come to a place of knowing you in a personal way this morning. Then, Lord, we call upon the name of the Lord. We give thanks this morning for what you've done for us. We thank you for this day, Lord. That this is the day that the Lord has made. That we rejoice and be glad in it this morning. We give thanks this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. I'm just going to shut off. And our brother's going to come on. And he's going to bring the Lord's table. So we'll be back online in 2 minutes. God bless you all.